Good evening and happy Sabbath to all of you. Thank you, Ba Haming. Kublai, they call it in his tongue. Kublai means thank you very much for that beautiful song. It somehow, the Lord in a very providential way matches the presentation I will be making. The Lord, I am willing to do your will. Let us pray together. Our Father, we thank you for this holy hour that you have given to us. May the word of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable unto you. Speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Discipling. We have been talking about discipling, right? And my topic. And I love it. Jesus, the Christ method. Some people say Jesus Christ method. But I like to call it Jesus the Christ, because he's the only one who can save us. Okay? So Jesus the Christ method of discipling. This is my passion and my love. All right, I hope I will not be carried away too long. But if I do, bear with me, because this might be my last to stand, you know. All right. Christ's method alone can give real success in presenting the truth to men. Christ's method is the best. So if you follow Jesus Christ, honestly, intentionally, you cannot be wrong. There are many scholars. Let's not talk about AIIAS scholars. They are good, but you know, in the world today, there are many scholars. Oh, they are expert, but they can go wrong. But when we follow Christ's method, you cannot be wrong, because Christ is all-knowing, all-powerful. So keep that in mind as we study God's word. William Carey, I love him because he was a missionary to India. He was known to be the modern missionary, the father of modern missionary. Just imagine. He came to India. We talked about learning, contextualizing, and so on. He came to India from his homeland, Europe. And he learned no less than 16 languages of India. Not only talk, you know, talk market language. Not only that, he translated the Bible into several Indian languages. Can you imagine? That is the reason I love him, I respect him. All right, he said, by the way, he was not sent under sponsorship. So he said, I am a disciple of Jesus. I am a disciple of Jesus. Christ, I couple shoes. In other words, he repairs shoes. He makes shoes for his living expenses. So my student, my friend, if you are self-supporting, rejoice. Sometimes you are getting scholarship and some support from here and there. Missionary William Carey has to sew, repair shoes in the marketplace. And he said, I work as a shoemaker to help me survive. But my business is what? Winning soul for Christ. Let's go to the next. We must understand, in order to do the discipling, in order to win souls, we must understand winning souls. For what? Why? Who? For whom? We need to understand that. Who Jesus is. Since this is a theological forum, I will assume that we are talking about the Master Jesus, our Lord. But do you really know Jesus, who he is? Do you really know what is his mission? What is his mission? I will go to that in a little while. What that means to you or to us and to you individually and to me? Do you understand what it means for you to be a Seventh-day Adventist church member? Do you understand what it means for you to be a Christian? Christian means followers of Jesus Christ. Christ's chain. Okay? Oh. Christian. Originally it was Christ's chain. Followers of Christ. Do you really understand the call for you as a Christian? How did Jesus make disciple of his followers? Are you disciple of Jesus? If so, why? We will try to cover those areas. I hope the officers here will not pull me down to the chair, to the seat, but we'll go on. Let's go to the next one. Christ's mission on earth. Okay. You know, I have taught for many years. Before you were born, I was already a teacher, my young boy, young man. Huh? Before you were born, I was in AIIAS. So I know what it means. When I was young, when I just started, I started teaching elementary school. Huh? So I know, if you are elementary school children running all over the place, I know how to control you. Huh? Then after that, I was asked to teach high school level. And I thought, wow, I'm already a teacher of high school. Huh? Then later on, they put me to be the principal of that school. I said, I must stay humble. Then I went and taught in the college level. Some of you are AUP student, right? I taught in AUP for many years. You were not there yet. All right, from there, I came to AIIAS and I taught master and doctoral students. So, if you don't behave, I know how to take care of you. I can simply call to my office and I'll have a few minutes of chat and you'll know I'm serious about your life. Okay, let's go to that. Christ's mission. What is Christ's mission? Rosalie, you were on the platform like a holy man. What is Christ's mission for coming to this earth? Tell me. To save us. You, if you were my student, you will only get B+. All right. One professor there, he made his presentation very well. What is the mission of Christ for coming to this world?
Seek and save the lost.
Better answer, A-. Not yet A. Okay, operator. Give up?
Yeah.
Give up? Then you better go out. All right. We don't have time to debate on this. Christ's mission for coming to this world to save the sinner is part and partial of the answer. To seek the sinner is part and partial, not complete. Christ coming to this world has a very simple mission. Let's go to the next one. What did he say? I have come down from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. Christ coming to this world, coming down from heaven, is to do the will of the Father who have sent him to this world. Let's go back to the previous one. He said to his mother, remember the story? Jesus was 12 years old. As a customary of those days, Jesus was taken to Jerusalem, remember? After the ceremony, after the Passover ceremony, Joseph, the father, and the mother said, let's go back. And Jesus was a good boy. And so they, on those days, it is dangerous to travel alone. So they go by caravan. They go together as a group. And the father and the mother took their journey back from Jerusalem to Nazareth. In the course of their travel, in their business, the father assumed that the mother will take care of their son. Huh? And the mother assumed the father will take care of the son in their business. And Jesus stayed back in where? In the temple. All right. Let's go fast. When they landed after traveling one whole day or more, they found Jesus was not found. It was already dark. Where is Jesus, your son? The father asked the mother, where is your son? And the mother said, that's your son? They could not find. The Bible says in Luke chapter 2 from 1 to 12, if you read that, you'll find that they went back, and by that time it was already 3 days. They went back to Jerusalem and they found Jesus. And the text says, when they saw Jesus, when they saw Jesus, instead of saying, oh, my son, I found you so nice, the mother asked, my son, where have you been? Why did you treat me as like this? Probably she shouted. I don't know. But the Bible says the mother, it was mother, by the way, and that's normal. When they are in tension, it's always the lady who speaks. Right? Anyway, it was mother who asked Jesus this question. Why have you done this to us? We have been worried. We have been searching for the last 3 days. And this is the answer of Jesus. And he said, that is Jesus. You see the capital, he, that is Jesus. He said to them, and he responded to both father and mother and said, why did you seek me? Did you not know that I must be about my father's business? He was very clear. His mission, his goal, and that was to do the will of the Father. Jesus did many things while he was on this earth. He's healed the sick. That's the will of the Father. He went preaching. That's the will of the Father. He found the sinner. That's the will of the Father. And he cleansed them from sickness. All of those are part and partial of Jesus' mission. And when you put all together, simply it means Jesus was there to do the will of the Father. Healing the sick, saving the sinner are part of the whole. All right, let's go to the next one. Boy, we have many things to go over. This is another. I wanted to make sure that you understand this philosophy, the mission of Christ. Here in John chapter 6, verse 38 says, "For I have come down from heaven." I read already. Let's go to the next one. Christ's mission must become our mission. Christ said, "I have come down." Brother Watson, I love you, but this is important for us. I have come down. You have come to AIIAS, not because you want to enrich your brain with knowledge and degrees, but you have come, Brother Abraham. You have come here to do the will of the Father and to fulfill His mission for you. You understand that, my children? It doesn't matter whether you are a professor or whether you are or the dean or the president or student or little child. It doesn't matter. God has a mission for all of us. And that is to do the will of the Father. To do the will of God. And if you are intentional, if you are purposefully planning to do God's will, you cannot go wrong, my brother. Don't struggle hard. It is simple to follow Jesus. Do what He wants you to do, and you will be well. You know, I like J.R., that little boy, my boy. J.R., what is the first lesson? Stand up and speak loud. He's been with us for some time, and I have been teaching him what is the first lesson. Yes, to obey. That's the lesson he has learned. Ever since he came to my house, together with the parents, as our special guests and my children, I taught this little boy, what is the first lesson I want you to learn? And that is to obey. And he's doing very well. He might be playing, and I said, JR, come. The first lesson, he said, to obey, and he will come. If we are children of the Lord, and God calls you, you obey. Not because you are powerful, but because you have surrendered and willing to disciple others. I like somebody lectured today. You cannot give. You cannot teach what you don't have. Therefore, first of all, in order to disciple others, make disciple of others to Christ, you have to be first disciple. And to become a disciple of Jesus, you have to do the will of the Father in your life. Simple as that. And everything will fit into your life and system. With no doubt, no chance to fail. Human beings are weak, but the Lord is powerful. And when we surrender our life, ourself, our mind, our being to Him, we can all be strong, successful, because Christ's method cannot go wrong. All right, let's go to the next one. Let me cite two samples of his method. Let's go to the next one. Peter, I love Peter, by the way, because my elder brother's name is Peter. I love him, even though he is not so kind sometimes to me. Huh? But I love him. Saint Peter was not a very lovable person to begin with. But when Jesus saw him by the seaside with his brother, and I consider Andrew like myself, you know. Of course, the difference is I talk more than my brother. But anyway, Jesus called Peter. And he called two names, Simon Peter, to ensure that there will not be a mistake in calling names. He said, Peter, Simon Peter, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. It took 3.5 years or so for him to really understand what it means when Jesus called. For some, it takes time. For some, it is so easy. Jesus said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. At that time, he did not understand. He had to be in the school, by the way, to study and get a college degree. It approximately takes 3.5 years. But today, it takes 4 years, right? 4 years degree. But if you study without stopping, and if you are a normal person with A and A minus, B, something like that, it will take you approximately 3.5 years. Peter probably is an average student. A little bit better than me in that case. I was under average, I guess. Anyway, Jesus stayed and worked with Jesus for about 3.5 years. Peter was trained well. And after 3.5 years, Peter became truly a disciple of Jesus. He gave his life for the cause, for the goal, for the mission that Christ has given to him. And so, if you give your life and allow Jesus to control your life, he will make you a successful person. Let's go to the next one. A man possessed by evil spirit was freed by Jesus. And after that, he was put to work immediately. Let's go to the story. The story is found in Mark chapter 5, verse 1 to 20. No time to read. I'm tempted to read. I love reading the gospel. But tonight, if you go home, read the story. It's just like a novel. Beautiful story, event, a history. The man was in the mountain place because he could not live with the society. He was possessed by devil. By the way, the devil, when they confronted Jesus, asked, what is your name? Huh? Legion. Legion is a commander in Roman army. He commands 600 footmen and 300 horsemen. That means at least 900 soldiers is in his control. And so if we interpret, there were at least 900 devils inside him. But Jesus says, you know, you go out. And the devil went out, find themselves to be with the pigs. Let's stop at that. You know the story. If you don't know, the more you should read tonight. When he went home, and when he was made well, when he made well, he wanted to follow Jesus. Jesus went, and his disciples went into the boat. And this man, who was a normal man, cleaned up already, ready to work, and he went into the boat. The Bible says he went into the boat. But Jesus says, my son, go home. Go home. Go to your friends. Remember this step. Go home. That's your family. Go to your friends, your neighbor, and then proclaim in Decapolis province. Go home, your immediate family, your brother, your sister, your children. Take care of them, my brothers. They are important. Make disciples of your children. Make disciples of your siblings, if they are not yet. It's your duty. That's a call for you. And then go to your friends. And then go to your province. And they don't say, you must practice homiletics that I taught you in the seminary. No. Simply, you know, making disciple is simply telling your experience, your relationship, how you have related with the Lord, your master. He says, go and tell what the Lord has done for you. What? If your relationship with the Lord is good, you will always have something to tell others about how the Lord has been compassionate on you. By the way, you know what this compassionate means? Love in action. If you find your friend, your neighbor is crying, don't simply say, oh, sorry, that's pity. Oh, you don't have money to eat, no food. Oh, I'm sorry, I'll pray for you. That's not enough. You have to be compassionate. That means you carry food and give them. That is compassion. Love in action. Jesus had compassion on those who came to him, whom when in the course of his travel, if they see someone needing help, he expresses his willingness to be compassionate. That's what we are called to do. Compassionate. I have cited two examples. That is making discipling of his people. Peter, he made disciple of Peter. So greatly that he became an evangelist. He became a missionary. He became a martyr, or he died for Christ's sake. That's this true disciple. This man wanted to be with Jesus. He wanted to follow. But Jesus says, go home. Go to your friend. Go to Decapolis, your province, and tell simply what the Lord has done for you. You get it? You don't have to go to Manila to go and preach. You have a neighbor, you have a close friend in Silang, your classmate. Those are the ones who you should work to make them disciples of Jesus. Let's go to the next one. Now, this is what I want you to do. We talk so much about baptism this afternoon. You know, we talk so much about, you know, winning souls. Ellen G. White, through the inspiration, wrote, many would be willing to work if they were taught how to begin. They need to be instructed and encouraged. That's why we say, let us nurture them. If they found Jesus and they want to give their life to Jesus, let us introduce Jesus and let them work. He says, many would be willing to work. Our duty as followers of Jesus is to teach them and to encourage them to share what the Lord has done for us. Let's go to the next one. Time is running out. When the soul is converted, set them to work at once. When a person is baptized, don't say, you wait until you learn everything. Don't say that. That's wrong. That's not right. The work of sharing God's love is in the hands of all of us who have been chosen by the Lord to be His followers. Therefore, if you have known the love of Jesus, get to work. Don't wait for tomorrow. Share what the Lord has done for you. Let's go to the next one. Let every church, that includes AIIAS, every church, all the churches in the Philippines, in India, in Indonesia, Korea, it doesn't matter where you come from. The churches where you come from must be a church that will train and witness for the Lord. Share not a deep theological truth, but the biggest truth about the love of Christ is your experience. What it means, Christ, to you. Let's go to the next one. I must close already, time up. Our officers are very kind, but you may be cursing me anyway. Huh? But let's go to this summary. Know your God. I didn't go to that detail, but God is all powerful, all loving, all wise. He created the heaven and the earth. Let there be water, and there was water. Let there be mountain. You know, in Hebrew, I took Hebrew many years ago, Dr. Larry Herr. And I was working, and I was going further and further from the lesson. And the exam came, and I said, okay, I must not fail. I must pass. And so that night, I crammed, real crammed. And I learned. I memorized for a few hours, and I got A grade. But then, right after the exam, I told my friend, exam is over, I did okay, I will pass. Now, my work is to try my best to forget those things. You know, and Dr. Larry was behind me, my professor, and he said, Paoring, let it take natural course to forget. Don't work hard to forget. Sometimes we don't like those courses, but it comes back. And, you know, when the Bible says, God made heaven and earth, it means, and Jesus said, let there be ex nihilo. That's a Hebrew word. Jesus spoke, Jesus ex nihilo mountain, and there was mountain. That's it. Let there be ex nihilo water, and there was water. That it means that way. He spoke, and the spoken word was so powerful that it existed. That's the kind of power Jesus has. Now, so know your God. Knowing is not enough. You must maintain personal relationship with Jesus. That's the important part. Pray to the Lord. Some of you are marriageable age. You pray to the Lord for a good husband. He will give you. Yeah, you are one of them. Don't simply laugh. Jose, keep your family well and with prayer, okay? You have just come for doctorate degree. Doctorate will help you to be a great man. But if you are bad to your wife, that's not good. You see? So you have to be prayerful and maintain relationship with the Lord. That is most essential. That's the core. You know, peripheral are like studying PhD, going to Manila and so on. But the core is to maintain relationship with the core, with the Lord. Let's go to the next one. Make Christ's mission your mission. Christ came, left heaven to do the will of the Father. Therefore, you as a Christian must make it intentional, purposeful, real to do God's will while you are in campus. Make disciples requires conversion. And unless you are converted, John chapter 3, unless you are born again, unless you are converted, you cannot what? See the kingdom of God. Jesus was talking to Nicodemus, leader in the society. He said, unless you are converted, unless you are born again, unless you have experience with the Lord, you cannot see. And see is not with your eyes. If you say see, blepo. In Greek, we use blepo, I can see you. But you know, John used the word harau, perceiving, imagination with your mind. That's what John referred to. Unless you are converted, you cannot see, perceive the kingdom of God, because that is spiritual matter. Oh, let's go. So, discipleship requires involvement, sharing, witnessing what the Lord has done for you, what you have been allowed by the Lord to learn in the classroom, outside the classroom. That's commitment. And the Lord will bless you and reward you. If you are following and doing the will of the Father, He will reward you when He comes, and He will call out, you are my faithful servant. Enter thou into the kingdom of the Lord. Not only you, but those whom you have shared the truth and discipled them in the Lord's vineyard. So, my children, my friends, my colleagues, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord reward you. I have one more week to go. I don't know. For sure, we will never be the same like this again. Some will not be able to attend this kind of function. But wherever you are, commit yourself to the Lord. The Bible, I have pointed out this in the seminary retreat, but I will repeat. Consecrate yourself to God in the morning. This is the first duty, step to Christ, page 83. Consecrate yourself to God in the morning. This should be the first duty. Another one. Those who make Christ first in your life, the last and the best, are the happiest people in the whole world. The secret of happiness. You don't have to be very rich to be happy. In fact, the richer you become, you know, if the Lord's blessing is not there, you will suffer more. But if you commit yourself to the Lord, choose Him to be your guide, your partner, you will surely experience the joy that you cannot explain. You only have to experience it. So, my brethren, the Lord bless you and keep you. Thank you very much, and good night. Oh, am I supposed to closing song? Okay.